good evening. It's good to see you all here. And again, welcome to all of you tuning in, as well as all of you here tonight, to the 44th National Conservative Student Conference put on by Young America's Foundation. In just a moment, we're going to bring on our special guest, who's not only the 33rd governor of the great state of South Dakota, but she's also an author. You all have on your seats or under your seats now her book called Not My First Rodeo. You'll understand in a little bit as you hear her and hear a little bit of this introduction why that's so appropriate. I was thinking, though, as I was backstage talking to her and some of the others, I think you're going to need an extra suitcase because you've gotten so many great books. But that's because we truly are invested in you, not only here, but when you go back to your schools, your communities. I want you to be trained with all the great knowledge to be successful leaders in the fight for freedom, not only for the next few years, but far into the future. So it's my honor, really, to introduce our special guest. This is the 44th National Conservative Student Conference. Last year, some of you joined us in Houston for the 43rd conference, right? It was a great time. Part of the reason why we held it in Houston, in fact, all of our big conferences, we had a Freedom Conference last year in Miami, Florida. We had this conference in Houston, Texas. We had our Rawhide Circle Conference in Rapid City, South Dakota. Why in all those cases? Because they were open. We knew that there were freedom-loving governors in each of those states that were going to keep things open. And I got a kick when we were in South Dakota for Rawhide. The lieutenant governor said about our guest tonight that she is as tough as a steak at a Waffle House. So if any of you eating a Waffle House know what we're talking about, but it's really true. This is someone who, appropriate when talking about not my first rodeo, thinking about being at the Reagan Ranch where she visited last fall, but really from her earliest time as a child on. How many of you in the crowd have grown up either on a farm or on a ranch or somewhere in a small town rural area out there? How many of you so you know how hard it is. And so our special guest tonight, Governor Noem, grew up in a farming community. In fact, not only grew up that way, but as you'll probably hear a little bit from her in a moment, sadly, her father died when she was off to college, and she had to come back and help her family get back on track and take care of that farm, take care of the ranch, and get things going in the right direction. But that made her tough. She wasn't intimidated by this. And then along the way, when she realized it wasn't enough just to be a small business owner on your own, there were a lot of things that the government did that got in the way of a lot of people who work hard trying to run their own farms, their own ranches, their own small businesses. And so instead of complaining about it, she decided after seeing some of the things they were doing, she was going to go run for the legislature, and she won, and she had a real influence and impact there. And then she realized a lot of those regulations and problems weren't just in state or local government. They were in the federal government. And so she was elected as the one and only member of Congress from South Dakota. And then 4 years ago, I think like a lot of us who've taken on the role of governor, she realized, wisely so, that probably the most important job in politics in America isn't in the White House, it's in the State House. It's being a governor, because governors can actually get things done, not only in their own states, they can influence positive change, conservative reforms all across the country, and she's done just that. In fact, last year when we were in South Dakota, it was interesting. We were up at Mount Rushmore. It was a little foggy that day, but earlier in the day, we were at Custer State Park, and we asked one of the guys as we were going out on the bison tour what it was like with tourism during COVID. And he said, we actually had our best year. He said, we've had more visitors than ever before. And I said, well, why is that? He said, well, one, we're outside. He said, but two, our governor, Kristi Noem, told the world we're open. She didn't shut things down. She didn't take on the mandates. And that state now has more people working than they've ever had before. The biggest challenge now is just finding enough bodies to fill all those positions, as we've seen over the last 2 years. But this is someone who is unintimidated. Like I said, her new book is called Not My First Rodeo. Years ago, after we took on the big government special interest, I put out a book called Unintimidated. And if you had to have a subtext for this title of this book, you could have Not My First Rodeo, She's Just As Unintimidated. Let's give it up for the 33rd governor of the great states of South Dakota, Kristi Noem.
What an honor and a blessing for me to be with all of you. How's your conference been? I've heard it's been fantastic, right? And I'm thrilled that you all get a book. I hope you enjoy it. There's a few stories in there about cows. Is that all right? I think every lesson in life can probably be taught to you by a cow. at a different thing that she's dealing with will teach you a lot about life. Listen, it is so wonderful to be with all of you and to be with unapologetic, freedom-loving patriots. It's not easy to be conservative on a college campus today, is it? When you stand for freedom, whether it's freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom of assembly, the right to life, the right to bear arms, you become a target. You deal every day with liberal professors, with fellow students, with administrators who work to isolate you. They make you feel alone. They try to make you feel like you're the only one who thinks and believes like you do. I'm going to tell you a quick story. I think most of you know that when I was going to college, my dad was killed in an accident. I ended up having to quit school, come home, and take over all the family businesses. We farmed, we ranched. I ended up starting a hunting lodge. We had a restaurant that we ran. But the story that is told during that time for me personally was that I was devastated. My dad was my best friend, and within a few months, we got hit very hard by death taxes. It made it very difficult for us to keep our family business. When I became the general manager and worked to run our operation, but got hit by those unfair taxes that hit us at a time of tragedy, I was not only dealing with the grief of losing my dad, but I was also dealing with the grief of losing my best friend. You know, years later, after paying off those taxes, which took us 10 years, and getting involved in policy because dad had raised me to not complain about things, but to fix them, I was having a conversation with my sister in our office one day. And she said to me, you know, I'm surprised that you never finished college. You never quit anything. Well, that bothered me. And so I started going back to school, started taking classes at night. At that time, I was serving in our state legislature. So I was raising our kids, running our businesses, serving in the legislature, and then taking classes part-time on campus as well. One fall semester, a professor of a class that I was attending offered extra credit to go to a conference on Constitution Day on campus. It was September 17th, and I don't know about you, I'm one of those nerds, but I never pass up an opportunity to get extra credit. So I went to campus, drove there in my pickup. It was at South Dakota State University to listen to a panel of five different professors that were going to be discussing that day this topic. Is the Constitution relevant for today's student? Now, the room when I got there was filled with hundreds of students. They were all eager to hear this conversation facilitated by respected leaders that were on campus, educated in that particular subject matter. Experts, supposedly. I was shocked sitting there that day when one by one, each member of that panel argued that the Constitution was not relevant for today's student. These so-called experts sat up there and said that this Constitution of our country was not relevant because today's student had not had the opportunity to debate the merits of the document. These so-called experts said it was not relevant to today's student because today's student did not have their perspective reflected in the writing. These so-called experts, and this was over 10 years ago, at that time, said that modern age had changed and that somehow the principles that were deemed in this foundational document of our country were unnecessary and that they were dated. Now, this being over 10 years ago, I never thought I would see that, much less see it in South Dakota. But I also still to this day will never forget how stunned I was. Stunned to sit there in this lecture hall and hear these educators discredit the foundational document of the United States of America. Not one of those professors seemed to appreciate the only reason that they could even have that panel in the first place was because of freedom of speech, let alone all the other rights that they've enjoyed all of their lives in this great country. But I was even more shocked that there was no opposing view presented that day. Not one of these highly educated people, these experts, could see a way that the Constitution mattered or even recognize the responsibility to provide an opportunity for a dissenting opinion. Now, years later, we are seeing the effects of that kind of uniformly anti-freedom thinking and teaching in our universities across the country. This is our challenge. For years, liberal anti-freedom viewpoints were the only perspective that were given within our educational system. At times, you may have felt isolated in your beliefs because a fair debate was not had on your college campus. Raise your hands if you feel as though at times there is no platform for a conservative viewpoint on your college campus. Conservative viewpoints are not given that same platform many times, especially not in relation to liberal ones. You are not alone. There are millions of Americans who cherish the gift that we were given in a government founded on inalienable rights given to us by our Creator, not by men or by governments, but that people possess the rights that God gave us. Now, I didn't grow up in a political household. My dad was a cowboy, and he was tough. Our politics were lived. They weren't talked about. In fact, one of the stories that I use as an example to teach people about what my dad was like was that when they passed a mandatory seatbelt law in South Dakota, I remember going outside one day and watching my dad cut his seatbelts out of his brand new pickup with his jackknife. I was surprised. It's not, he wore his seatbelt. He, you know, used it. He didn't think it was bad. He was upset and angry because the government told him that he had to wear it. Now, my dad demanded a lot out of his kids. He worked hard, he had integrity, and he expected his children to be excellent. Every day was an adventure with him, and I knew from the time that I was a little girl that I wanted to grow up and to be just like him. We were raised working together every day, and we were in church every time the doors were open. Growing up on our ranch, there was a sign that hung over the gate in our horse pasture that I led my horses through every day when I took them to and from the barn. There was a sign that hung over that gate that had a quote on it, and that quote said, "There's nothing so good for the inside of a man than the outside of a good horse." When America elected a new president when I was just 9 years old, I remember seeing a picture of him, and it was a president that wore a cowboy hat. From that moment, I was all in for the Gipper. My heroes had always been cowboys, but it was many years later when I first learned that that saying that had hung over the gate in our horse pasture was a quote that President Ronald Reagan had used. And apparently my dad had been a big admirer of his as well. Now, the Young America's Foundation is an organization founded on the ideals that President Reagan embraced and lived throughout his lifetime. On being a part of this organization right here, you are honoring all that represents the best of America. The hope that we all need, that this republic our founders gave us, will not be lost. It's here in you because this organization ensures that our history will not be forgotten. You will not forget the sacrifices of those who came before us, and neither will I. We need to defend the legacy of our founding fathers in order to preserve our future that's based in freedom and liberty. That is our sacred responsibility. And this is what I really want to talk to all of you today about. You are America's rising generation. You are capable of great achievements, and we need you to do great things. You're going to accomplish those great things by keeping focused on the one thing that made America the greatest nation in history, and that is freedom. You are a part of an incredible story that began almost 250 years ago. It's up to you to continue doing that work. And it is a great task. It's a calling, a mission. Our people need you to hold on to this last best hope for humankind on earth. We need you to defend the legacy of our founding fathers. Extend that legacy to your children and to your grandchildren. Many years ago, at the beginning of our story, the entire country, these united independent states had been waiting. They were hoping and praying to find out what our founders were working on in this building, that when these meetings that they were calling the Constitutional Convention. They were holding their breath, waiting to see what kind of a government they had decided to give them, what framework this country would have. You remember the story, a woman passed by Dr. Ben Franklin on the street and asked that very question, and Dr. Franklin said back to her, "A republic, madam, if you can keep it." Now I know, I'm aware that Nancy Pelosi and her liberals have tried to steal that story. They've tried to politicize it, to push their agenda, just like they want to steal our country. But they don't get to steal it. Preserving this republic is the duty of this generation. Your generation is up next, and you're going to have to guard it, protect it, and fight for it. Our founders built something that the world had never seen before. They took the best of Western civilization from Jerusalem to Athens to Rome to London. They brought together faith and reason, law and representative government. And in Philadelphia in 1787, they put all of that together to craft the Constitution of the United States. They set out a Bill of Rights, making it clear that certain rights could never be infringed on. The right to speak and to assemble. The right to worship and to act on those beliefs in the public square. The right to arm ourselves against standing armies. And the right to a fair criminal justice system. They acknowledge that these rights come from our Creator and that free people honor their Creator when they exercise those rights to govern themselves wisely. Now, too few of your peers are not aware of this, or they don't believe it today, and the left's relentless assault on America's college campuses is one of the reasons why. So let me get back to Ben Franklin. You know, Ben Franklin's quips often carried with them this ominous tinge. They were often edited, actually, in history books. Another one of his famous quotes of the founding era comes just before George Washington had been elected to be the first president. Franklin stated this: "The first man put at the helm will be a good one. Nobody knows what sort may come afterwards," he said. But that isn't the full quote. He continued, "The executive will be always increasing here, as elsewhere, till it ends in a monarchy." He knew the tendencies of man, the eternal quest for power that many people would pursue. A founding era episode involving the nation's first Chief Justice, John Jay, makes Dr. Franklin's point exactly. After Jay committed to joining Alexander Hamilton and James Madison in writing essays in defense of this proposed Constitution, Jay was seriously wounded by a mob of New Yorkers who had been whipped into a frenzy by rumors of grave robberies. Jay's wounds derailed his involvement in our nation's greatest work of political philosophy, the Federalist Papers. You know, a justice recently recalled this John Jay story, and he wrote this: "It is sadly ironic that John Jay's efforts to educate his fellow citizens about the framers' plan of government fell victim to a rock thrown by a rioter motivated by a rumor." A reporter pointed out that the connection between Jay's day and ours that this justice was making. This reporter wrote, "In our age, when social media can instantly spread rumor and false information on a grand scale, there is even greater danger that political passions can turn us against each other or against a constitutional government itself." The point this justice was making is not much different from the point that Ben Franklin made when he said the founders had given us a republic if you can keep it. What does it take to keep a republic? I would say that it all starts with us talking to each other. We have to stop talking past each other and viciously attacking everyone who disagrees with us. Many in this country have disagreed on political positions and they become offended. In response, they attack, they lash out, some even resort to silence. They quit talking at all, and that is wrong. You know, when I married into my husband's family, quite a few of them were Democrats. And if you can imagine, I took their name, and then I ended up running for Congress in one of the top five races in the nation that year as a Republican. I'm sure they dearly loved that. Can you imagine? Well, over time, it's interesting because many of these family members have since re-registered and become Republican. And do you think that that happened because we attacked each other over the Thanksgiving Day dinner table? No, it happened because we loved each other. We built a relationship. We had discussions, and over time, they learned I was right. No, I'm kidding. No, I would say that over time we all agreed that there was more that we agreed on than what we disagreed on. And we have to teach all of our young people in the country again to engage in civil debate. Thankfully, all of you know that. It's why you're a part of Young America's Foundation. But now part of that civil discourse is having these honest conversations about differences in policy and the effects of those policies on our way of life. Generations of Americans have been educated on perspectives opposing the Constitution. And this has happened intentionally. Joe Biden and the left have waged war on the Bill of Rights for over 50 years. And now they're doing it in increasingly dangerous and destabilizing ways. Freedom of speech is at the top of their list. Liberals want to criminalize dissent on election integrity, COVID-19, climate, critical race theory. If you dare speak up, you will get prosecuted, punished, or professionally ruined. Now, the American people consistently reject the left's vision, and when they do, how does the left respond to them? They use state power to force people to get on board. Get vaxxed or get fired. Wear a mask or no service. Use this language or get canceled. Increasingly, this unelected expert class is exercising power over our lives and our livelihoods. Never forget what they tried to do last year. The National School Boards Association worked with the White House to get the FBI to identify parents as domestic terrorists for opposing critical race theory in their kids' schools. Now President Biden's economic policies are also making history, but in the very worst way. It is up to you to have civil discourse and to tell the truth. Inflation is at 9.1%, a 40-year high, and life in America continues to become more and more expensive for young people and more expensive for those that are most vulnerable in our society, the poor, the elderly, and those living on fixed incomes. We're losing control of our own ability to grow our food in this country and to feed our people. For years, I've educated others on the fact that food security is a national security issue. When another country controls our food, that is when they control us. And this is happening under Joe Biden as countries like China become increasingly entrenched in our food and fertilizer supply chains. They buy our processing companies, and now we're seeing more and more of our land being purchased by them. President Biden and the Democrats are fundamentally incapable of solving these problems because they don't have the foundational beliefs needed to solve them, and because they don't believe in freedom. So when you're looking for a leader, or as a leader yourself, you need a foundation that's anchored in truth. And if you do not hold to truth, if everything in you is negotiable, then you have no stability at all. You will have become so flexible that you have no foundation, and you are fake. We see this a lot in American politics today. I work with people every day who have no idea what they believe or why they believe it. I hear people consistently say, oh, I like this person's economic policies, or this man or this woman, they talk good on national security, or I like how they fight on this issue. Well, maybe, but what's their foundation? What will they believe when the going gets tough? What will they do when the whole world comes crashing down on them, when everyone's against them, when it's imperative that they do the right thing? What happens when the coordinated ad campaigns begin? Or the endless avalanche of elite opinions, hit pieces come out and get their friends to call them up and harass them into changing their mind? What happens when the media relentlessly lies about the decisions they're making and distorts the truth? Well, I've been in that spot. When I refused to shut down South Dakota during the pandemic, when every other state in the entire country made different decisions, I became that target. And no one had my back. No one defended me when I was the only governor who refused to shut down businesses. No one defended me when I was the only governor who refused to enforce and impose unconstitutional mandates. But I stuck to what I knew was the truth. I relied on my foundation, on my trust in American freedom based in our Constitution and the personal responsibility of our citizens. I don't think any of you in this room probably knew who I was before 2020. Before the liberals on national TV like Elizabeth Warren and Rachel Maddow started attacking me night after night on the national news, declaring that I was reckless, that I was irresponsible, that I was dangerous. I remember one Sunday morning, I was doing an interview with George Stephanopoulos, and he actually asked New York Governor Cuomo to give me advice because I would be coming on next. Yes, that Governor Cuomo. The one who sent vulnerable seniors to their deaths in nursing homes and then tried to cover it up. It was absurd. Yes, you can. You know, I think I did what every other governor in this country did. I did study the science, I researched the data, I talked to experts. But what happened then is that I took another step. I talked to my general counsel. I listened to constitutional experts. I wanted to fully understand what authority I had as governor and what authority I did not have. Because I believe that when leaders overstep their authority, especially in a time of crisis, that that's how we lose our republic. Now, South Dakota was the only state in the country that never once closed a single business. In fact, I never even defined what an essential business was in our state because I don't believe that governors have the authority to tell you that your business isn't essential. I never stopped people from going to church, never mandated anything. I stood in front of my people and I told them I was going to trust them. I'd give them all the information that I had and I would let them use personal responsibility to make the best decisions for their families. And I said to them that we would get through this challenge together. Now, other states did close and they did enforce mandates and closures of different kinds. Their kids lost precious times in their classrooms and they suffered because of it. Economies were crippled because of regulations and restrictions. Law and order was eliminated by leaders who emboldened criminals and disrespected law enforcement, and people in those states lost hope. It's heartbreaking. Last year we lost 106,000 Americans to drug overdoses. But I want you to look at South Dakota. Right now in South Dakota, we have the best economy in the country. We had the least amount of business closures from the pandemic, the least amount of hours lost by any worker in the country, the least amount of wages lost by any employee. Over the last 3 years, our people's incomes have grown by 21%, the most of any state in the nation. When the president offered elevated unemployment benefits, I was the only governor in the country that turned him down. I said, "Thank you, Mr. President, for the flexibility, but we don't need it. Our people want to work." Today I have in South Dakota less than 700 people in the entire state that are on unemployment. Everybody's working. We've taken in historic revenues from our thriving economy through South Dakota, but I want you to remember, we have no income taxes. We have no personal or corporate taxes, no personal property taxes. All we have in state government that funds our state government is a 4.5 cent sales tax, and we are breaking records with the amount of revenue that's coming in because our economy is thriving and so are our people. We have a historic budget surplus. And in 2020, just two states in this country had declining overdose deaths. New Hampshire, theirs decreased by 0.5%. South Dakota's overdoses went down by 16%. Our people are happy, and they're happy because they're free. Since I've been governor, we've paid off debt. We've put historic amounts into trust funds and into reserves. We've repaired dams, built railroads. We have the best pension fund that's fully paid in the state of South Dakota. We have a AAA credit rating and we've built roads and bridges. I had a vision to bring high-speed internet access to every single home in the state. We fully funded it in 1 year. Woo! Woo! We have a constitutional requirement in our state to balance our state budget. Through all of this, South Dakota has emerged as the best example of freedom in the nation. We have become the starkest contrast to Joe Biden's America. We have accomplished this by focusing on freedom. Now, Joe Biden's America wants to take away your freedoms, like the Second Amendment. South Dakota is setting the bar for defending the Second Amendment. The very first bill... The very first bill I signed after being sworn in as governor was constitutional carry. And this year, we became the very first state in the nation to waive all fees for concealed carry permits. In fact, I will even pay for your federal background check. In South Dakota, it won't cost you a penny to exercise your Second Amendment rights. Now, Joe Biden's America doesn't even recognize the basic differences between biological males and females. In South Dakota, I brought and signed into law the strongest bill in the nation to protect girls' sports and to defend fairness for women. And we didn't stop there. We banned critical race theory from our universities, and today in South Dakota, we are protecting and saving unborn lives, and we are helping mothers in crisis as well. We're making sure that moms know that help is available with them, no matter what situation that they may face. In South Dakota, we are the best example of freedom that's working. And that's why the left attacks us and tries to dismiss us. Freedom matters. It makes real, tangible changes in people's lives for the better. It gives hope. The left ignores freedom because for them, it's not about making people's lives better. It's about power. Our nation's first principles can be found in one of the greatest documents in human history, the Declaration of Independence. The governments are instituted among men to preserve our unalienable rights. Among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And life comes first. So many in our country are being bombarded right now with only one side. I'm here to be the counterbalance. Now, more than ever, you have got to be the counterbalance. You have to be the dissenting voice. You have to speak the truth. This is the only way that we're going to keep our republic. It is time for truth, and people are hungry for it. They get nothing but lies and fear all day, every day. You must be different. You have to bring hope. People who are threatened by the truth will say anything about you, and they will try to frighten you into not speaking it. They may tell you that you are divisive or that you are full of hate. Don't believe them. Fear is the left's strongest weapon, but do not be moved by fear. Be motivated by love and truth. They are much, much more powerful. I want to close today by going back to Constitution Day, to September 17th. If you know American history, you know that date is especially significant for a very different reason. To this day, September 17th, 1862, remains the bloodiest 24 hours in American history. And it occurred during a battle in the middle of the Civil War. An estimated 23,000 young American men were killed or wounded from sunrise to sunset that day. Over what? The Constitution of the United States. It mattered to them. It mattered to those who were fighting to preserve our Union. There's a scene that's recorded in history by one anonymous soldier who fought in that battle. As one of the regiments was, for the second time going into the conflict, a soldier staggered, and it wasn't from any wound that he had been inflicted with, but he was in a group of dying and dead people through which they were passing, and he looked down and he saw his father, who was laying there dead. Another man who was already wounded, but who knew them both, pointed to the father's corpse, and then he pointed upwards, saying to him, "It is all right with him." Now, that son moved onward and kept walking, passing right by his father's dead body to go do his duty and to advance on the enemy. Antietam National Battlefield is not far from where you are right now. It's just a little over an hour away from here, and I'm going to encourage all of you to go there sometime. Walk the grounds. Hear how quiet it is. Feel the sense of terrible loss that lingers there. Then ask yourself if the Constitution still matters today. These young men, they bled and they died to keep this republic. Most of us won't be called on to do anything close to that. But we better be willing to do the work that's set out for us to keep this republic they gave us. You will not be alone. You'll have each other. Look at the tables around you. Look at the people next to you. It is a blessing to be engaged in this work with these individuals. I'm incredibly blessed and grateful for the opportunity to do it as governor. Every decision we make isn't about taxes or policy or regulation. It today is about our Constitution. It's about our foundation. It's about protecting this way of life and this country that those men and those women who came before us gave us. I'm so grateful for the Young America's Foundation for doing everything that they do in this fight for freedom. And I'm grateful for all of you for choosing to stand up for freedom in your corner of the country. Talk to people, love people, but speak the truth. And thank you so much. God's going to bless you. He will bless your work. And God bless the United States of America.
Thank you, Governor Noem. We're going to move into a brief time of Q&A. Please state your name, your school, and please keep your questions brief. Thank you.
This is the fun part. You guys excited? All right.
Good evening. Good evening, Governor. Thank you so much for being here with us tonight. My name's Therese Purcell. I'm from the University at Buffalo. Uh-huh. As you may know, Vice President Pence was with us here on Tuesday, and he talked about the path forward for us conservatives. I was just wondering, it seems like the conservative movement is somewhat divided at the moment between more populist leaders like Trump and Josh Hawley versus your traditional conservatives like Mike Pence and DeSantis. I was just wanted to know your thoughts on where do you see the future of the movement going?
Well, it's a little bit of what I referenced when I was speaking with you earlier about being offended by each other. Years ago, I had a pastor say to me, Kristi, people are going to throw out offenses at you all the time. But you're the one who decides if you want to pick it up and carry it around with you. But then you're the one who's carrying the burden. And even in the conservative movement, we've gotten offended by each other. We focused on the one thing we disagree with each other on, and it's making us least effective. When we fight with each other, we lose. And I hope that what you all have been thinking about during this entire week of the phenomenal speakers that you've listened to is that it's not worth it. It's not worth it to be offended by that one issue or that 10% of the issues. It literally is a fight for our country right now. So make a decision every day. Would you get offended by someone else who holds your same conservative values to make the decision not to bend over and pick up that offense, but to let it lay and walk right on by knowing that you don't have to carry that burden. You continue the work to protect freedom that this country needs so desperately.
Thank you, Governor.
You bet.
Hi, my name is Caitlin Ireson, and Caitlin. I'm from University of Tennessee. First of all, you have me sold on South Dakota.
Oh, good. How many times?
So my question is, I know in politics sometimes there is still pushback for women in positions of power. And I'm going into civil engineering, and sometimes there is still that pushback whenever women are rising into power. What's your biggest piece of advice for any woman in the audience today that is facing that pushback? What advice would you give for us to stay strong in that push?
You know, what I would just say is many times with women, they'll tell us if we have an opinion, we're divisive, you know, or argumentative. I would tell you, make a decision to still speak your mind and perspective, because it's incredibly important to better policy to have it. I've spent my entire life working in a man's world. So I was a general manager, farmer, rancher, drove semis and trucks for many years, served in the legislature when there was very few women got elected to Congress with very few Republican women and now one of the few women governors. And what I do to not let that affect me when people maybe treat me a little bit differently or look at my opinions differently is I make decisions on how I will choose to look at that criticism myself. One of the greatest things that my parents taught me was to be teachable every day. Even your greatest critic, you can learn something from. But I don't watch the news. I'm sure you guys would be shocked by that. But it's bad for me mentally to turn on the news and all you hear is that negativity consistently. I don't read my comments on social media. And if you guys are putting nice things on there, thank you very much, I appreciate it. But when you hear that negativity all the time, it does affect you. So for me, I'm very much an introvert. People don't know that. I love people and I love being with all of you. But if I was gonna go do something, you know, that would make me feel energized, I'd probably go sit in a tree stand or go chase cows or something. So, you know, people don't know that giving speeches is still very difficult for me. They don't know that, you know, interviews, every time I'm on TV, that I probably have sweat rolling down my back because I'm still very nervous about it. So there's a perspective that a woman has that maybe we get treated a little differently sometimes because we have a different perspective, but I would say it's incredibly important you be engaged. I passed a bill when I was in Congress that said that when we would negotiate peace agreements with other countries, that a woman needed to be at the table. And the reason is, you maybe don't know this, but historically, peace agreements last much, much longer if there's just a woman there in the discussion, because many times when countries are at war, the men are off fighting the war, the women are running the businesses. The women are the ones taking care of health care and running the economies. And they know what it takes to keep peace in their country. So that perspective and diversity around a table when you're having a policy discussion is incredibly important. And don't let the fact that many times you may be in the minority think that maybe your perspective isn't needed. It's incredibly important for long-term stability, not just for our country, but for our way of life.
Thank you.
You bet.
Hi, Governor Noem. My name is Molly, and I am a student at St. Louis University. As a daughter of a small business owner in a blue state, my family really felt the pain of COVID. How are you, now that the pandemic is winding down, how do you plan on continuing to support small business owners in your own state and possibly on a national scale?
Well, for us, it's all about setting an example. So because we never closed our small businesses, you know, they had an opportunity to thrive when many were crippled across the country. You also probably saw that we did a national advertising campaign at the middle of the pandemic. Did any of you see the South Dakota ads inviting people to come and visit? People did, overwhelmingly. Our largest industry in South Dakota is agriculture. Our second largest is tourism. And that is thousands of small businesses that host people, restaurants, gas stations, hotels. And women-owned small businesses are thriving in South Dakota where they weren't anywhere else. Small businesses need flexibility. They need certainty. They need to know they're not going to have the rug pulled out from underneath them. They need to have low taxes, low regulations, and making sure that we provide that kind of stability and flexibility gives them a chance to survive in our state. What I do consistently is hope that people that are looking for an example of how that can benefit people economically will look to South Dakota. For years and years, we as conservatives have talked about what we believe. In South Dakota, we just did it, and it worked. So we have people that across the country are desperate for hope, and all we have to do is look from state to state to see the consequences of leadership and what it meant to have good leadership and bad leadership in every state. So that certainty and the flexibility for a small business owner is incredibly important. And I hope that you all recognize you've got people paying attention now that maybe didn't care about government or politics before, but they do now because of what happened to their families and businesses. And it's a unique opportunity to educate them about that tax policy, that regulatory policy that keeps the government off their back. The number one question you should be asking everybody in your life that says, a policymaker or a government should be doing this for you, say, is that a job that the government should do? Or is that a role that a church should fill, or a nonprofit, or a family member? Because that's what people really are questioning now with what we see going on in so many of our small towns and states.
you.
Thanks, you, Molly.
We have time for one final question.
Oh, I'll talk less. We'll try to go through a couple. I'm sorry, guys.
Hi, my name is Natalie Hester from the University of Tennessee. My question is about the transition from a working class career into politics. So I'm a civil engineering major, okay. And I plan to work as a civil engineer. But I've always had a passion for servant leadership, but I have no doubt that I'll definitely want to get involved in my community mm-hmm. at some point when I'm fed up with it. So what advice do you have for people coming from typical working class careers wanting to transition into politics like you did?
So you're going to get opportunities to do things and you just need to say yes. I think most of you are probably thinking, I'm not sure what my career will be. I'm not sure what my next thing will be. I want to run for public office. I don't know what to do. People will give you opportunities and you need to say yes to them. It may not be something that you think you want to do or would enjoy, but you may do that for a period of time and realize you have a gift or a talent that you didn't know you had. You might meet somebody at that meeting or serving on that committee that completely changes your life forever. Your next boss or mentor or someone might be there that helps you find your career path or helps you find that gift or talent that brings you joy and helps you to be successful for the rest of your life. All of you have been told in your life that your education is important, and it is, but I will tell you that your life will be dramatically changed by relationships. The people that you meet and talk to, stop in the hallway when you see someone, introduce yourselves. Relationships will make or break your success in life. So don't forget the value of going to new places, taking advantage of new opportunities. It may not be that experience, or that may not be your dream job, but you may meet somebody there that truly does change your life forever. Yep.
Thank you again, Governor Noem. Here we're going to have our final question.
Okay.
First of all, Governor Noem, thank you for allowing me to ask an additional question. My name is Gabi Weissman, and I'll be attending Yeshiva University.
Perfect.
You obviously share an incredibly special perspective coming from the heartland and being really on the scene, especially in things like the frontier thesis, what made mm-hmm. the United States of America. And so with this special perspective, what can you share about ranching or raising cattle or really working in a way that most of us from urban areas will never have the experience? So what can you share about that type of life that we kind of miss out on the urban area, and what did that bring to politics?
Well, I would say that my dad consistently gave me impossible things to do. And I thought, as a young child, that maybe he was trying to kill us. You know, he gave us things all the time that there's no way he should have been giving young children that job. For instance, he never taught me how to drive a semi. One day we were just driving down the road, leaving a field, and he remembered he had to bring the other truck home. So he said, Kristi, jump over here, grab the wheel, take this thing home, make your corners wide. I'm bringing the other truck home, and he jumped out the door. So I remember diving across the cab at 12 years old, grabbing the wheel, and having no idea how to drive a semi, going home, never shifting gears. I pulled into the yard of the ranch 10 miles later, didn't know how to shut off the semi or stop it, so I just turned the key and let it drift to a stop. And I remember the first thing I thought to myself was, I cannot believe that I lived. But the second thing that I thought was, I bet I can drive anything now. And that's what I think we're doing in this country, is we're crippling our children. We've got parents that think that they have to do everything for their kids, and that's not our job. Our job is to prepare them for life. I read a book recently about people's perspective on life, and I'm sorry this is a long answer, but I want you guys to remember this. Your perspective in life will change everything about how you deal with anything that comes your way. There's people who have enabling attitudes and disabling attitudes. And this book had to do with how you deal with stress. People view stress very differently. There's some people who have a hard time or a crisis in their life, and they view that as a terrible thing. Oh my goodness, I've got so much work. This hard thing's coming my way. It's so terrible. Isn't this awful? That's a disabling attitude. But there are mental coaches that train our professional athletes to have enabling attitudes. They see stress as a historic opportunity to achieve great things. They see a situation that's very hard or difficult as a chance to overachieve and to do something never done before, unprecedented. And that their ability to get through those situations and how they approach it mentally can be trained by adjusting just their perspective and their attitude. I'd encourage all of you to, when you look at hard things that come your way, to approach it with an enabling attitude. Something hard comes your way, a test, a job, a challenging individual in your life, see that as an opportunity to do something historic. Something once in a lifetime that will be and cause you to overachieve. Have an enabling attitude, it'll make all the difference in the world. That's what we've done in this country. If you turn on the news at night, you hear journalists and broadcasters talk, they'll constantly say, aren't you scared? Aren't you worried? Aren't you fearful? Never say those words. We have a unique opportunity in front of us. We should wake up happy. We're incredibly blessed in this country. God gave us the greatest gifts, difficult things to do, but it gives us an opportunity to make history and to continue to preserve this amazing country. So I'd focus on doing that and become a problem solver that we need to really keep making America the special country it is.
Thank you.
God bless you. Have a wonderful evening.